الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، continuing with the رسالة or محاضرة lecture that Sheikh Rabi' bin Hadi al-Madkhali gave about 8 years ago in Masjid Imam Subayl in Mecca. And alhamdulillah, this is the transcription of his lecture, and it's regarding the hadith Ad-Din al-Nasiha. We read the first part in the first sitting, and this is the second sitting, inshallah, and we'll continue. فَالنَّصِيحَةُ لِلَّهِ, the advice to Allah in the hadith Ad-Din al-Nasiha, Ad-Din al-Nasiha, Ad-Din al-Nasiha. قُلْنَا لِمَنْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَالَ لِلَّهِ. قال الشيخ ربيع حفظه الله: هي توحيده بأنواع التوحيد. نصيحة لله is his توحيد regarding the categories of توحيد. توحيد الربوبية, توحيد in maintaining Allah سبحانه وتعالى's oneness with regards his lordship. بأن نعتقد أنه خالق, that we believe that he is the خالق, the creator, هذا الكون, أنه خالق هذا الكون. وربه, that he is the خالق, the creator of all of this creation, and he is their lord. ومنشئه, and he is the one who originated it. ومدبره, and he is the planner. سبحان الله, as Allah سبحانه وتعالى says in the Quran, ألا له الخلق والأمر, ألا له الخلق والأمر. To Allah سبحانه وتعالى belongs, indeed, to Allah belongs the خلق, the creation, and the أمر, and the affair. Affair belongs to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. وما تشاءون إلا أن يشاء الله. Even your own will is under the will of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And Sheikh Rabi حفظه الله, he mentioned in his Sharia class, when he was teaching a Sharia class more than 8 or 9 years ago, he mentioned that likewise here the Mashi'ah of Allah سبحانه وتعالى is from his rububiyyah, is from his lordship. So nothing goes outside his lordship. Allahu Akbar. That everything is under his lordship. For he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the first and the last. As Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Hadid, هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن. He is the first and the last, and the highest and the nearest. He is the first and the last. Shaykh Ubayd ibn Abdullah al-Jabri, hafidhullah, he said, he is the first, as in the hadith, if someone is inflicted with dain or of debt, he says, as in he mentions part of the hadith is, هو الأول ليس قبله شيء. He's the first and no one before Allah. وهو الآخر ليس بعده شيء. And he is the last. There is no one after Allah سبحانه وتعالى. وهو الظاهر ليس فوقه شيء. And he is the ظاهر, the highest. There is no one higher than Allah سبحانه وتعالى. He's the highest. As Allah says in the Quran, إليه يصعد الكلم الطيب والعمل الصالح يرفعه. To him rises the good speech, and the good actions make it rise even more. And to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ulu. This is proof of Allah being above the arsh. Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa. These are some of the verses which clearly show that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the arsh. As Allah mentions, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa. He mentions it at 7 times in the Quran. Mentions that he is above the arsh. 7 times in the Quran. And likewise, in the qissa or the story of Isra' al-Mi'raj, the Messenger ﷺ went up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if Allah was not above, why would he go up? Why would the Messenger ﷺ go up? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the heavens. I know that many of the misguided groups, they deny that Allah is above the arsh. Because when you say to them, Allah is above the arsh, they will say to you that you are putting Allah in a place. We say to them, that you are the one who made up the word place. We didn't mention the word place at all. Because place is created. And Allah is not created. Allah is the creator. He's the khaliq. Ba'inun min khalqihi. He is separate from his creation. Meaning he is above his creation, not below. He is above, not inside. Because many of the Sufis, ashab wahdatul wujud, those who believe that Allah is everywhere. And inside the creation, and the creation is Allah, just like Ibn Arabi. They went astray because of this, because they used their intellect in precedence of texts. of the Quran and the Sunnah in the understanding of the companions? Which of the companions believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere? In fact, even Aisha radiallahu anha, look, subhanAllah, the aqidah of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they believed, they had no problem with this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the arsh. When it rained one time, what did she say? She says it came from above. As it trickled on her, she says it came from above. Shuf, subhanAllah, fitra. Aisha radiallahu anha. And other than Aisha, even the slave girl, hadith Sahih Muslim, hadith Muawiyah ibn Hakam al-Sulami, Ayn Allah, when he asked, when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the slave girl, where is Allah? What did she say? Fi sama'. In some narrations she pointed up. Fi sama', above. Fi in Arabic language can mean inside or can mean above. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَامْشُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَامْشُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Go in the land and see the affair of those who were before you, how they were dealt with. So here, fi means above. وَامْشُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ doesn't mean go inside the land, it means go over the land. So fi in Arabic language has has a meaning that it is above, that it means above. And likewise here, it means above. That وَهُوَ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَفِي الْأَرْضِ. And he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is in the heavens and in the earth. Doesn't mean inside, it means above the heavens, above the skies, above the earth, above creation. And also if we look at the books of Aqidah of the past, this is exactly what the A'imma, the scholars, have mentioned. If we look at, for example, Al-Qirawani, Ibn Abi Zayd Al-Qirawani, from the Maliki scholars in the 4th century, he said a beautiful statement refuting the Ash'aris. A beautiful ibara, simple. He said, وَهُوَ فَوْقَ الْعَرْشِ بِذَاتِهِ. Look how powerful that is. And he is above the arsh by his essence. وَهُوَ فِي كُلِّ مَكَانْ بِعِلْمِهِ. And he is everywhere in terms of his knowledge, not in terms of his self and essence. In terms of his self and essence, he's above the arsh. But why did Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qirawani say this? Because many of the Asha'ira, this misguided group, who liken Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who actually try to run away from tashbih, liking Allah from creation, but they end up falling into speaking about Allah without knowledge. And Allah says, وَلَا تَكْفُوا مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصْرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا. Don't go into that which you have no knowledge. For indeed, the sam', the hearing, the sight, the heart, all of that will be questioned. All of that the person is responsible over. So, when they speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being above, what did the Asha'ira say, the Asha'ira? This misguided group, who, if they followed Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari rahimahullah, when he turned back away from the way of the Mu'tazila and the way of the Kullabiyya, then they would have fallen into, يعني, then they would have followed the straight path. But they stayed upon Abu al-Hasan's second stage, and that was when he was a follower of Ibn Kullab. And that is when he, Abu al-Hasan, used to believe, just as the Kullabiyya, the so-called Asha'ira today, they are Kullabiyya, because they are followers of Ibn Kullab, they do not believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the arsh by his self and his essence. Rather, they say he is above the arsh by his status, by his rutbah, or his يعني, ability, he's above the arsh. But as for by his self and essence, then they deny that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they say, if you say that, then you are putting Allah in a place. But we say to them, subhanallah, first of all, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِعُ بَصِيرٌ. There is none like unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he is all-seeing, all-hearing, all-seeing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. To Allah belongs the best of examples. You can't give example like the example of creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is high above that. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Surah Maryam 65, he says, رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا فَاعْبُدْهُ وَاصْطَبِرْ لِعِبَادَتِهِ هَلْ تَعْلَمُ لَهُ سَمِيًّا. You Lord of the heavens and the earth, and that which is between them, everything, Allah is the Lord of all. Subhanallah. This is Rububiyyah. فَاعْبُدْهُ وَاصْطَبِرْ لِعِبَادَتِهِ. So worship him and be patient upon his worship. Uluhiyyah, second category of Tawheed. Third category, هَلْ تَعْلَمُ لَهُ سَمِيًّا. Do you know any similitude to Allah? And obviously the answer is no. Rhetoric question. No, there's no one similar unto Allah. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. And there is none comparable unto him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we say he's above the arsh by his essence and his self, just as he has affirmed for himself, just as the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has affirmed for Allah, then this is clearly affirming that which he has affirmed. We did not bring anything new from ourselves. And this is the aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah with regards the ulu of Allah. And if you want to see further discussion, then alhamdulillah, we've translated the explanation of the hadith of Jariyah, where is Allah, by Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah. You can go back to that and see some of the confusions that the Asha'ira bring and the answers to them. Because if we do not step up our da'wah, then we will find that we will become confused by the smallest of shubha or doubt that comes to us. So we have to be ready in terms of the misguided groups. We have to be ready and know their plots and plans and know their deviations in order not to fall into that. That's why the Arabs, they say, عَرَفْتُ شَرَّ لَا لِشَرِّ وَلَكِنْ لِتَوَقِّيهِ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَعْرَفَ الْخَيْرَ مِنَ الشَّرِّ يَقَعْ فِيهِ. I have known the evil, not because of for the sake of the evil, but to keep away from it. And whoever does not know good from evil will fall into it, will fall into the evil. And Hudayfa radiallahu anhu used to say, كَانَ النَّاسِ يَسْأَلُونَ رَسُولَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَكُنْتُ أَسْأَلُ عَنِ الشَّرِّ مَخَافَةً أَنْ يُدْرِكَنِي فَأَقَعْ فِيهِ. People used to ask the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم about the good, and I used to ask him about the evil, fearing that I will fall into it. So we have to know enough to keep away from the evil. We have to know enough to keep away and not fall into the evil. وَأَنَّ لَهُ صِفَاتِ الْكَمَالِ. Sheikh Rabi' Hafidullah says, وَأَنَّ لَهُ صِفَاتِ الْكَمَالِ. That Allah subhanahu to him belongs the complete sifat, attributes. Subhanallah. All of his attributes are perfect. وَأَنَّهُ ذُو الْعَظَمَةِ وَالْجَلَالِ. And to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the possessor of greatness and honor. Allahu Akbar. وَأَنَّ لَهُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. And to Allah belongs the most beautiful of names. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. And to Allah belongs the beautiful names. So call him by those names. Not as Zakir Naik, he said, you can call Allah by Nirvana, the Hindu God's name. Nirvana. This is not from Allah's names. So how are you saying you can call Allah by this? Nirvana. A'udhu Billah. Even if it means God, Allah belongs the most beautiful of names. So we only call Allah with his names. الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر as in سورة الحشر سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى. To him belongs the most beautiful of names. له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم. شيخ ربيع حفظه الله continues وأنه المعبود الحق. And Allah subhanahu is the one who deserves to be worshipped. He has the right to be worshipped. He is the one who is worshipped truly. الذي لا تعن الوجوه إلا لجلاله وعظمته. That the people do not turn to him except because of his greatness and his exaltness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is honorable. ولا تذل وتنقاد وتخدع إلا لعظمته وطاعته وطاعة رسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام. And you will not find the believers humbling themselves and complying to Allah Azza wa Jal, except obviously due to His greatness, exaltness, and they obey Him, and they obey the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all the messengers. وَالْإِيمَانُ بِكُتُبِهِ. And likewise, we find the believers believing in the books that were sent down. لِأَنَّهُ حَكَمٌ. Because these books that have been sent down, the last of the Qur'an, they are the judge. The Qur'an being the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in it there is justice, he says. Adlun, in it there is justice. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsan. Indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enjoins good and righteousness. Ahkam al hakimin, and that is the judge of all judgments, subhanallah, the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the judge of all judges. He is the judge of all judges. Malikul muluk. Wa arhamur rahimin, and he is, subhanallah, the arhamur rahimin, the most merciful amongst those who are mercy. He is the most merciful. Ar-Rahman, عَلَّمَ Al-Quran, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ. Ar-Rahman, Allah described himself as being the most merciful. And Ar-Rahman in the Arabic language is in the wazan of al-fa'lan, which basically means the one who, which means extensive, something which is extensive. Yani, this word conjugation means extensive. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-Rahman, means that His mercy is so vast and extensive that even the kuffar are given water to drink and food to drink by ar-Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is general. As for Rahim, this is specific for the believers. وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. And He is Rahim, kind, merciful to the believers. And this is a specific type of mercy. And Rahim, just so you understand the difference between Ar-Rahman and Rahim, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah says Ar-Rahim is in the conjugation Al-Fa'il, which means that the one who delivers the mercy, yani the deliverance of mercy. So Ar-Rahman, this is general. Allah is Ar-Rahman, He gave the disbeliever life just like He gave the believer life. But for the believer, Allah is Rahim over him. He's protecting him. He's looking after him. And also He not only gives him food and drink, but also He guides him further and further to the truth. Yani closer and closer to the truth, sorry. So this is Ar-Rahim. He delivers that mercy to him, subhanAllah, to the believer. وَأَنَّهُ عَدْلٌ لَا يَظْلِمُ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enjoins justice and He doesn't oppress not even an atom's weight. Allah does not oppress anyone, not even an atom's weight. Subhanallah. يعني not even that level. فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَأَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ مَطْوِيَّاتِ بَيْنَ بِيَمِينِهِ subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He says that the samawat, the heavens, will all be rolled up in His right hand. And this is in accordance to the verse which is in Surah Al-Zumar, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا قَدَرَ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبْضَتُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ. That the samawat will all be rolled up in His right hand. This is in Surah Al-Zumar. And the Shaykh Rabi' Abu Dawud continues and he says, وَأَنَّهُ يُمْسِكُهَا أَن تَزُولُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who made the sky in the way it is without falling, without moving from its place. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُمْسِكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَن تَزُولَ. So it would not be removed from its place, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is controlling it and who is planned it to be in that way. وَلَئِنْ زَالَتَا إِنْ أَمْسَكَهُمَا مِنْ أَحَدٍ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ حَرِيمًا غَفُورًا. So again, clearly showing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is holding the heavens and the earth and all of creation in a particular orbit or particular path. وَهُوَ الَّذِي يُمْسِكُ الْعَرْشَ وَهُوَ أَضْعَافٍ. And is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is, again, holding up the arsh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is holding up the arsh compared to the creation, is indeed great. Because the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam described that the whole of creation, and we subhanAllah have not only seen, we've seen just like a keyhole of what the creation is. We have not seen the whole of creation. The creation is great indeed. We have only seen a fraction. And when you see subhanAllah, the scientists speak, when they speak about the stars, the planets, the solar systems, the Milky Ways, when you see all of that, you say, subhanAllah. And Allah subhanAllah is the creator of all of that. And we are just like nothing. SubhanAllah. We're nothing. هَلْ أَتَى عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا. SubhanAllah. Allah subhanAllah mentioned that we weren't even mentioned. We weren't even in existence. And yet Allah subhanAllah gave us life. Sheikh Muhammad Al-Aqil says, a beautiful benefit where, subhanAllah, that Allah subhanAllah gave you life when you were without life. And He gave you this life without you giving Him anything before that. You did not give Him anything before that. And out of His mercy and fadl, honor and blessing, He gave you this life. So this is an amana, this is a trust that Allah subhanAllah has given us, the fact that He has given us this life. وَهُوَ الَّذِي يُمْسِكُ الْعَرْشَ. So the heavens and the earth and all of the creation, compared to the kursi, is like a ring in a desert. And the kursi compared to the arsh is like a ring in a desert. SubhanAllah. between and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the arsh, the hamalat al arsh, alayha thamaniya. Upon it are eight carrying the arsh. Eight angels. Between the earlobe of one of them and the shoulder of one of them is the distance of a bird flying for 600 years. Subhanallah. That's the hamalat al arsh. How great Allah is. وَهُوَ الَّذِي يُمْسِكُ الْعَرْشَ وَهُوَ أَضْعَافُ 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 Sheikh Rabbi says, هَذَا الْكَوْنَ الَّذِي نُشَاهِدُهُ أَضْعَافُ هَذَا الْكَوْنَ Far, far, far greater than this creation that we see. And وَيُمْسِكُ الْكُرْسِي وَهُوَ أَضْعَافُ 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 مَا نُشَاهِدُهُ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also holds the kursi. He is the one who is the owner of the kursi. He is the one who has no need of the kursi. SubhanAllah, because it's creation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it. And it is far, far, far greater than the creation. And what we see. And even what we don't even see. مَا نُشَاهِدُ مِنَ هَذَا الْكَوْنِ وَيُمْسِكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَنْ تَزُولَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى يَنْبَغِي He says, it is a must. أَنْ نُدْرِكَ عَظَمَةَ اللَّهِ We must. Realize the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَنَّهُ رَبُّ هَذَا الْكَوْنِ وَسَيِّدُهُ That he is the Rabb, the one who is the Lord of all of this creation. And he is the Sayyid. وَسَيِّدُهُ وَخَالِقُهُ وَمُدَبِّرُهُ And he is the one who deserves all honor. And he is the one who deserves, who is the creator of it and its planner. وَأَنَّهُ خَلَقَ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ And Allah created the jinn and the ins. لعبادته for his worship وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون and we have not created jinn and mankind except that they worship him ما نريد منهم رزق وما أريد أن يطعمون إن الله هو الرزاق ذو قوة متين Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Dhariyat that indeed we have created the jinn and mankind that they worship me and I do not ما أريد منهم من رزق I do not want from them any risk any sustenance and provision Allah doesn't want that from you Even when you sacrifice, it's not the dima, the blood that reaches Allah. It's not the meat that reaches Allah. It is the taqwa that's in your heart that reaches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَيَجِبُ أَنْ يَخْدَعُ لَهُ So it's obligatory that the people humble themselves to Allah. وَيُذِلُّ لَهُ And they become humility, they have humility towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَنْ يَخْشَوْهُ وَأَنْ يَتَّقُوهُ And they should fear him and have piety. يعني concerning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَنْ يُصَدِّقُوا أَخْبَارَهُ And they should believe in his akhbar, the akhbar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because whatever Allah says, it is truth. The Qur'an is the speech of Allah, غير مخلوق. And we'll come to that in the section of Qur'an. وَيَخَافُوا وَعْدَهُ وَوَعِيدَهُ And they fear, they should fear his wa'd, his promises, and the threats that Allah has threatened us with. The hellfire, the punishment of the grave, the dajjal, and the calamities of this life, trials and tribulations of this life and the hereafter, and what is going to happen in the Qiyamah. We should have fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning this, that each and every one of us will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without a turjuman, without a translator, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will address us. And that will be considered to be the ard. As the Messenger said to Aisha radiallahu anha, that is the ard between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you remember such and such? Do you remember such and such? Did my angels, kiram and katibin, ya'lamuna ma taf'alun, the angels who write everything that you do, did they oppress you? No. Do you remember such and such? You even forgot about it, and Allah will bring it forth. Subhanallah. Even the atom's weight inside a rock or in the heavens and the earth, Allah will bring it. Allahu Akbar. As Allah mentions in Surah Al-Luqman, Even if it be an atom's weight, you will see it. So don't think anyone is free. Don't think anyone is able to escape this hisab, this accountability. Every one of us is going to be responsible. And there are exceptions for the shuhada and so on and so forth. But every one of us is going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how do you want to meet Allah? The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet him. And he said, whoever hates to meet Allah, Allah hates to meet him. How do you wish to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Upon your current state, upon our current state, how do we wish to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Maybe tomorrow we will die. Maybe tonight we will die. Maybe next year, maybe we only have a few years left. How are we spending our times? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, نِعْمَتَان مَغْبُونٌ فِيهِمَا كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ الصِّحَّةُ وَالْفَرَاغُ. Two things people waste most, their good health and free time. Many shabab wasting their time, not in talab al-ilm, not in studying their deen, not in learning about Allah, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they are using their time in that which is wasteful. And they are not studying closely with Ahlul Ilm or listening to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made studying easy for the believers. You have the internet, you have the ability to travel. And my advice to each and every one of you and myself is that you travel and sit with the ulama. Sit with the ulama and benefit from them. 5, 10 years, 15 years. Don't go for 6 months, 1 month and then come back. Go, benefit, humble yourself, come back, help the da'wah, help. Build. Don't come back to destroy. Come back to build. And when some of the people were trying to use the tazkiyah of Sheikh Rabi' for themselves, Sheikh Rabi' Hafidhullah a couple of months back wrote an article in Sahab where he said, sahab.net, Arabic website, where he said, the actions of the person, they are his tazkiyah. They are his tazkiyah. So people use my tazkiyah and say that I have praised him and I have praised and so. But the actions of the person are his tazkiyah. And Shaykh Al-Albani, rahmatullah, in one of his tapes, he said, what is the benefit of a tazkiyah on Yawm Al-Qiyamah in front of Allah? What is the benefit except your actions, ya ikhwan? On Yawm Al-Qiyamah, all of us are going to be accountable. And Shaykh Muhammad Al-Aqil, hafidhullah, said, the angels don't only write down what you do and what you say, but they also write down the cause of problems that you are of. Yani the cause of problems that you are, yani that you have done. The causes. You may have said one word and it's caused so much fitna in the community. You may have yani preceded the ulama in your ijtihad, in something that you have said. Subhanallah, and you caused so much fitna. You are responsible in front of Allah because of that. Not only because what you said, not only because what you did, but also the reasons for problems that you are cause of. So how are we going to be in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with much fitna that we have caused, or much confusion that we have caused? So we have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are firm and who are patient, and also those who tread this path, humbling themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not being a cause for fitna, not being a cause for problems. The only thing people know about you is mashakil, is problems. Why? Build. The Rasulullah used to build communities. Shaykh Rabi Hafidhullah, he moves on to the next part of the nasiha of Rasulullah, and that is likitabihi. This religion is advice not only to Allah, to show clearly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who deserves to be worshipped alone, and likewise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs to the most beautiful names and attributes, that we have to believe in them and not deny them, and we have to believe in them without ta'wil, without explaining them away, other than what the meaning is, and what the meaning has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We believe in them without denial, without ta'til, without tahrif, without distortion, without ta'wil, without explaining away, with knowledge that we haven't been given. Rather, we accept them as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned them, and we affirm them for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just as He affirmed them for Himself. The aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah is well documented in the books of the Salaf. And this is clearly the aqeedah which we have just mentioned. Oh, he says here, وَلِكِتَابِهِ. This religion is advice towards his book, the Qur'an al-Azim. وَالْمُعْجِزَةُ الْخَالِدَةِ. This is the miracle which is khalid, which is forever. No one will be able to bring a Quran like it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. If you are in doubt as to what we have revealed, and produce to be surah like it, just a chapter. There are 114 chapters, produce one like it. And if you cannot, and you shall not. Look, subhanAllah, the authority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you cannot, and you shall not. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَنْ تَفْعَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةِ. So fear, or prepare yourself for the fire whose fuel is men and stone. And before that he said, if you are in doubt as to what we have revealed, then produce a surah like it. And call your witnesses if you are truthful. وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَنْ تَفْعَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةِ. This is the Quran which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent. And it is the miracle which is until the end of time. It's a miracle. Nobody will be able to bring the Quran like it. عَجْ الَّتِي عَجَزَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ. The jinn, all of the jinn and all of mankind fell short in bringing something like the Quran. يعني bringing like the Quran. أو بعشر سور من مثله. Or 10 verses like it. Or surah like it. Or even less than that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the test and they failed. And they will fail. Because this is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not created. The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are from his that, and he speaks wherever he wills, whenever he wills. And he says to whom, he speaks to whomsoever he wills, and he speaks whenever he wills. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to the angels. Allah spoke to the angels. Said to them, bow down to Adam. Allah spoke to Adam. Ya Adam. Uskun anta wa zawjaka fil jannah. He spoke to Adam. He spoke to the angels. Wa idh qala rabbuka lil malaikati isjudu li Adama. Fasajadu al malaika. Then the angels, all of them bow down. Illa Iblis. Except for Iblis. Aba wa stakbara wa kana min al kafirin. He rejected, turned away. Abba, with haughtiness and pride and arrogance. And he's from the disbelievers, Iblis. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He spoke to Musa. وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Spoke to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will speak to you on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So this is from, and Allah will speak to the people of paradise. Allah will speak to the people of paradise. And the people of hellfire, they are so humiliated, they can't even address Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Instead of addressing Allah, they will address Malik, the gatekeeper of hellfire. What will they say? Ya Malik, liyaqdiya alayna rabbuk. Oh Malik, let your Lord destroy us. Let your Lord destroy us. Notice, Shaykh Nu'taymiyyah rahmullah says, look what he said. He said, let your Lord. They didn't say, let our Lord. He didn't say, Ya Malik, liyaqdiya alayna rabbuna. He didn't say, let our Lord destroy us. He said, let your Lord destroy us. They can't even say our Lord anymore. Because they are in such a humiliated state. And in the other verse, وَقَالُوا لِخَزَنَةِ جَهَنَّمْ وَقَالُوا لِخَزَنَةِ جَهَنَّمْ اُدْعُوا رَبَّنَا اُدْعُوا رَبَّكُمْ sorry, أَنْ يُخَفِّفَ عَنَّا يَوْمًا مِنَ الْعَذَابِ. And they will say, the people of hellfire will say to the people, to the gatekeepers of hellfire, وَقَالُوا لِخَزَنَةِ جَهَنَّمْ اُدْعُوا رَبَّكُمْ. Call upon your Lord. They didn't say our Lord. Call upon your Lord. SubhanAllah. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah says, this is total humiliation. Because they cannot even address their own Lord. They say, call upon your Lord. That he will lighten the punishment. They didn't say, remove the punishment. And yukhaffifa. They didn't say, and yazula. Just takhfif bas. That's all they want. Is to reduce. Because they know they're not deserving of the being out of the punishment. So they say, just reduce. And they said, yo man, only one day. They want the punishment to be reduced only for one day. They didn't say forever. Shaykh Nu'taymeen rahimahullah says, this shows you clearly the state of their humiliation. That they can't even ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly. وَهَادَ الْعَجْزُ لِلْثَّقَلَيْنِ. And this deficiency of not bringing a Qur'an like this Qur'an, the Qur'an, the speech of Allah, then this is ajz, this is deficiency from both the jinn as well as mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنِ اسْتَجَارَكَ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. And when one of the mushrikun asks for you, yani asks to be hired by you, hire them that they may hear the speech of Allah. Subhanallah. Is there any verse clearer than that to show you the Quran is the speech of Allah? Look how clear that verse is. وَإِنِ اسْتَجَارَكَ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ فَأَجِرْهُ حتى يسمع كلام الله. The Quran is the speech of Allah. وهذا العجز للثقلين الجن والإنس أن يأتوا بصورة من مثله من أوضح الأدلة على أنه كلام الله حقا وأن محمدا رسول الله. So this is so clear, صلى الله عليه وسلم, that this, because they can't produce a Quran like it, then in reality, this is the clearest of proofs that this is the speech of Allah and that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is the messenger of Allah, صلى الله عليه وسلم. له معجزات عظيمة أعظمها هذا القرآن. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم has great miracles. The greatest of all his miracles that he came with, يعني that it was revealed to him, is the Quran. الذي حوى من العقائد والتشريعات والفصاحة والبلاغة, that which consists of beliefs as well as legislations as well as فصاحة والبلاغة, eloquence. وأمور أخرى and other affairs. لو اجتمع الإنس والجن أولهم وآخرهم على أن يأتوا بصورة من مثله لما استطاعوا ذلك وقد بذلت محاولات كثيرة ففضح المحاولون. And if they were, يعني, he said, if the first of them and the last of them were gathered together in order to bring about the Quran like this Quran, they would not be able to bring it, even though they would put much effort. And not only that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expose them. Allah will expose them. For indeed Allah protected the Quran. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. We have sent down this dhikr, this Quran, and we are the ones protecting it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Kahf, Alhamdulillahi alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja qayyiman liyunzira ba'san shadidan min ladun. Here again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that the Quran is not crooked. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has revealed to his slave the Quran. And it is not crooked. Allahu Akbar. And not only that, he said, قَيِّمًا, it is upright. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah in his tafsir says, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala negated deficiency for Quran and affirmed perfection. Alhamdulillah, الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا. There's no crookedness, no deficiency, no mistakes in the Quran. قَيِّمًا, and it is upright. Allahu Akbar. This is the Quran, which all of us are encouraged to read daily. All of us must not turn away. As Allah mentions about those, اتَّخَذُ قُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا, they took the Quran by what? Instead of reading it, they boycotted it. Nasal Allah Salama. They boycotted it. They kept away from it. They only bring it out when somebody dies. The Quran is for the living, not for the dead. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam never used to read Quran over the dead people. The Sahaba radiallahu never used to read Quran over the dead. They never, because the Quran is the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's for the ones who are alive. So you cannot pass the Quran to the dead. There is no proof to say that. There are certain things you can pass to the dead, like Hajj, for your relative. As in the hadith of Shubruma. You can do Hajj for your deceased parents. You can do Umrah for your deceased parents. Satullah. You can make dua for them, supplicate for them. These are some of the things that are legislated. But as for sending the Quran to the dead, the Quran has not been sent down for that. The Quran has been sent down to be read over, to be read, to be pondered over. And thirdly, to be acted upon. These are the three reasons for the Quran being revealed. Other than that, then it's not for the dead. Sheikh Rabi Hafidullah says, أَمَّا الْعَرَبْ فِي عَهْدِ الرَّسُولِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فكانوا يحترمون أنفسهم مع أنهم يطعنون فيه لكن كانوا يدركون أنهم لا يستطيعون أن يأتوا بمثله بأقصر سورة مثل سورة الكوثر. سبحان الله. The Arabs themselves, in the time of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, they used to themselves, يعني before they used to respect themselves, but they used to, even though they used to curse and revile the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, but what they realized was that they couldn't produce a Quran like it. Not even the smallest of surahs, Surah Kauthar. They couldn't produce Surah Kawthar. Or even Surat al-Asr. And the one that professed that at that time was Musaylama. قَبَّحَهُ اللَّهُ Musaylama al-Kadhab, he tried to produce some verses similar to the Quran. فَفَضَّحَهُ اللَّهُ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposed him. وَحَاوَلَ بَعْضُ الزَّنَادِقَ And also some of the heretics, they also tried to يعني, bring that which is similar to the Quran and they fell short and were deficient. And they were not even able to bring the smallest of surahs like the Quran. فَنُؤْمِنُ بِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ وَأَنَّهُ كَلَامُ اللَّهِ So we believe in the Quran and we believe that it is His speech, the speech of Allah. وَنُعَظِّمُهُ And we exalt this Quran, we honor the Quran. Not by putting it on the top shelf, let the dust gather on it. But rather read the Quran, benefit of the Quran, learn from the Quran. The more you read from the Quran, the more you'll humble yourself. The more you don't read the Quran, the more arrogant you become. Because the Quran shows you who is the one who has full authority. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how much we are in need and how weak we are. وَنُنَزِّهُهُ And also, not only we exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but نُنَزِّهُ We also believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from any deficiency. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from any deficiency. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَنَحْفَظُهُ And also, before that, نَزِّهُ also, that we respect the Qur'an. وَنَحْفَظُهُ And we should memorize the Qur'an. Two people came to Sheikh Rabbi's house when I was there. This was maybe about 9 years ago. They came to his house. One of them was in a wheelchair. And the other one supposedly was limping. And the Sheikh looked at them. When he saw them, he said, are you from the Jama'ah of Bin Laden? Because Bin Laden, we all know Bin Laden, caused the people to destruction, caused the people to blow themselves up, and so on and so on. He praises these things. So when his Sheikh was obviously, at that time in a very good mood, mashallah, tabarakallah, and he was welcoming them in a nice way. He said, you are from the Jama'ah of Bin Laden? And they came in, Sheikh welcomed them, they sat down. And the Sheikh said, they asked two questions. One of them, the first one said, Ya Sheikh, I've memorized half of the Quran. The first one said, Ya Sheikh, I've memorized the whole of the Quran. What's your advice to me? And the second one said, I have memorized half of the Quran. What's your advice to me? Sheikh Rabi looked at them. He looked at the first one, he said, as for you, you memorize the whole of Quran, memorize the Sunnah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And as for you, memorize half of the Quran, memorize the other half. Simple. Our da'wah is simple. Don't need to reinvent anything new. But the da'wah is simple. So we are encouraged to memorize Quran because you will be, on Yawm Al-Qiyamah, it will be said of you, recite according to the last verse you know. And each Whatever you know, you will be raised according to that degree. So, reading the Qur'an, pondering over the Qur'an, acting according to the Qur'an, and also acting according to the Qur'an. نُحِلُّ حَلَالَ That which is halal in the Qur'an, we say is halal. وَنُحَرِّمُ حَرَامَ That which is forbidden in the Qur'an, we say is forbidden. وَنُصَدِّقُ أَخْبَارَ And we believe the akhbar, the news that has come in the Qur'an. وَنَخَافُ مِمَّا فِيهِ مِن نُصُوصِ الْوَعِيدِ And we are afraid of that which is contained in terms of the threats, the texts which are referring to hellfire and so on. نَرْغَبُ وَنَخَافُ We have raghba, desire. We worship Allah upon desiring to meet Him as well as being afraid of Him. أَشَدَّ الْخَوْفُ the highest or the highest of any fear. يعني basically fear Allah much. وَنَطْمَعُ فِي مَا فِيهِ مِن نُصُوصِ تُرَغِّبُنَا فِي مَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَفِي الدَّارِ الْآخِرَةِ And also we yearn for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us concerning those affairs that have been promised for the believers in the Akhirah, in the hereafter, from reward, from great reward. الَّذِي أَعَدَّهُ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ يَخَافُهُ وَيَخْشَاهُ وَيَتَّقِيهُ That which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for those who fear Him and who humble themselves to him, have awe towards him, and are pious. ونتفقه في أمثاله التي لا يعلمها ولا يعقلها إلا العالمون. And also we should have good understanding with regards to those parables that are mentioned in the Quran. For indeed none knows it except the عالمون, the possessors of knowledge. نعكف عليه علما وعملا. So we must not just sit down with the Quran, but long periods of time, he says, we must be with the Quran. فهذا من النصيحة لكتاب الله. This is my advice, and this is the advice of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with regards the book of Allah. فالنصيحة لكتاب الله أن نعنى بهذه العناية. So the advice towards the book of Allah, that we concern ourselves with the Quran, utmost concern. وأن نعرف خاصه وعامه. And we should know its general affairs as well as its specifics. وناسخه ومنسوخه. And that which abrogates and that which is abrogated. ومحكمه ومتشابه. And also know the muhkam, those affairs which are clear, and those affairs which are متشابه, which are unclear. And the unclear matters, we leave it. فمن اتقى الشبهات فقد استبرأ لدينه وعرضه. For whoever keeps away from the shubuhat, then he's free from blame in terms of his honor and in terms of his deen. ونؤلف بين المحكم والمتشابه. We bring them together. We bring the mutashabih, bring it back to the muhkam. That which is doubtful, bring it back to that which is clear. So we understand them. ونعيد المتشابه إلى المحكم. وهكذا نعنى بالقرآن كما عني به الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم وصحابته الكرام. Just like the companions used to concern themselves with the Quran. For indeed we have narrations that the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, he prayed one night and he prayed the whole of Baqarah and he prayed the whole of Imran and he prayed the whole of Nisa, subhanAllah. And the companion who was with him, he said, hamamtu an atrukahu. يعني hamamtu an akhu. He had a bad thought. And that bad thought was, that he wanted to leave. It was long. SubhanAllah. And many times we read from the Sahaba رضي عنهم how when they stayed with the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم in the night, like Ibn Abbas رضي عنهم, when he stayed with the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم one night, he came to his left side and he took him by the ear and he put him on his right side, so showing him and teaching him where to stand in the prayer with the Imam, clearly showing the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, he used to pray the nights and he used to concern himself with the Quran. And when Aisha radiallahu anha saw him in this state, she said, "Yani, you are promised paradise, and this is your situation." And he said, "Afala akunu abdan shakura? Should I not be a grateful slave?" And this is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Fallahu tabaraka wa taala akram Muhammadan sallallahu alaihi wasallam bi hadhihi risala. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa taala blessed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with this risala, with this message, with this Quran. Wa akram al ummata bi hadha al kitab. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed this ummah with this Quran. Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. You are the best of nations that have come out to the people. Ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhawna 'anil munkar. You enjoin the good because you enjoin the good and you forbid the evil. Limada saru khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. Why would they consider to be? Why do they end up being the best people that have come out to mankind? لأنهم آمنوا, because they believed, بهذا الكتاب وعملوا به, because they believed in this book and they acted according to it. Many Muslims, unfortunately nowadays, they have the Quran and they don't act according to it. Look at the Muslim Ummah nowadays, the shirk that they have fallen into. If you go to Asia, if you go to Africa, if you go to the Middle East, and we complain about Palestine and Iraq, of course our situation is going to be humiliated. If we don't turn back to the Quran, make it halal that which Allah has made halal. Make it haram that which Allah has made haram. In our lives, first and foremost, before we point fingers at others, look at ourselves, look at your children, look at your wives, look at your families. This is what you are first and foremost concerned with. And yourself. قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. Save yourselves from the hellfire whose fuel is men and stone. عَلَيْهَا مَلَائِكَةٌ غِلَاظٌ شِدَادٌ لَا يَعْصُونَ اللَّهَ مَا أَمَرَهُمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. And upon it there are angels, stern and mighty, and they do not go against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They fulfill that which they have been commanded with, and they don't go against His command. So the believers, they believe in the book of Allah. They act according to the book of Allah, He says. وَمِنْ أَعْمَالِهِمْ أَنَّهُمْ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. And from their actions is that they enjoin good. What is the greatest good? التوحيد. الصلوات. عبادات. توحيد is the greatest good. And توحيد is apparent in your ibadah. When you go for hajj and you say, لبيك اللهم لبيك. Here I am, O Allah, I'm at your service. لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك. Here I am, O Allah. Do you have no partners? إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك. To you belongs the hamd, all praise. And all blessings from you, subhanAllah. وإن تعد نعمة الله لا تحصوها. For indeed, if you were to count the blessing of Allah, you would not be able to count it. Just one, let alone many. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us all this. وَلَكَ الْمُلْكِ. And to you belongs the mulk, the dominion. لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ. The Talbiyah, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentioned about 18 fawaid of the Talbiyah. 18 benefits of the Talbiyah. From it is an affirmation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears, because you're not speaking to somebody who doesn't hear. From it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, because the one who you say, here I am, is going to order you and command you with something. So this is proof that he speaks when he wills and to whomsoever he wills. And from it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this, you humble yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ لَبَّيْكَ, and so on and so forth. وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, and they forbid the evil. And the greatest of all evil is a shirk. Shirk, to associate partners with Allah. For indeed Allah would never forgive shirk. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah will never forgive shirk. And he forgives anything else besides that to whomsoever he wills. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ قُلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ بَلِ اللَّهَ فَاعْبُدْ وَكُن مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. This is what has been revealed to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to those before him, that if he was to commit shirk, then his deeds would become null and void. And the Anbiya, they all call to Tawheed. وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا عِبُودُ اللَّهِ وَاسْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. But indeed, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا, sent to every nation a messenger, and they called to them was, worship Allah and keep away from the false deities. So this is Tawheed, and this is al-Shirk. And in the narration of Ibn Mas'ud, radiyallahu anhu, he said, أَيُّ ذَنْبٍ أَعْظَمْ. What is the greatest sin? What did the messenger Sa'im said? أَنْ تَجْعَلَ لِلَّهِ نِدًّا وَهُوَ خَلَقَكْ. That you make with Allah a partner while He's the one who created you. Allah created you, you give your worship to other than Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran that we should give our life and our death for Him, for His sake, not for anybody else. Na'am. That, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. لِلَّهِ, not for anybody else. لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Indeed, he says, my prayer, my sacrifice, when you sacrifice the sheep for Allah's sake. Now we have many people who claim to be upon this Islam, and many Muslims, unfortunately, whether they are in Africa or Asia, you find them, what do they do? They go to the grave and they sacrifice for the grave, for the man in the grave. This is happening. This is not something which is hidden. We have many graves built above the ground like domes. Look at the grave of Khomeini on the internet and see how big it is, like a villa. Look at the graves of many Muslims that have been built above the ground. We find the people oppose the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Abi Ayyaj al-Asdi qala li Ali ibn Abi Talib, ala ab'athuka ala ma ba'athni Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ala tada'at imthalan illa tamastahu wa la qabra mushrifan illa sawaytahu. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ali ibn Abi, Abi Ayyaj al-Asdi, one of the tabi'een, the successors, he said that Ali radiallahu anhu said to him one day, shall I not send you with what the Messenger sent me with, that you do not leave an ornament figure except that you disfigure it, and you don't leave a grave that is honored above the ground except that you level it. And Baqi' in Medina used to have domes over the graves of this Sahaba and the family of the Messenger. They used to have domes over them. And it wasn't until the coming of Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah and Malik Abdul Aziz, following that da'wah, the da'wah of Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah of Tawheed and Sunnah, that you find now, you go to Baqi', the graves have been leveled. Yani, according on the ground. Because when the graves are honored and they are raised, then what do the people do? They say, oh, how great this is. They start worshipping them by calling upon them. by supplicating to them. And Allah says, ادعوني أستجب لكم. Call upon me and I will answer you. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. Those who are too proud to worship me, they will enter into the hellfire lowly, humiliated. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. And when my slave asks of me, then I am close. Allah is close. فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. I'm close to the person. Subhanallah. And some of the Salaf said that verse in Surah Al-Qaf, وَهُوَ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. He's close to you to the jugular vein. That refers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qirwani said that. Refers to Allah in terms of his knowledge. That he knows where you and he sees what you're doing. So keeping away from shirk. And calling the people and families away from that. Many, many people. The umbrella is here. Masallah salama. And they have these false beliefs regarding Allah. They have these false beliefs regarding the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They think he's not human. They think that he is light without a shadow. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a bashar, a human being. قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَٰهُكُمْ إِلَٰهٌ وَاحِدٌ فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. He's a human being. Allah said to him, say to the people, I'm a human being like you. The only difference is what? That I have been given revelation. What is the advice in revelation? That you are sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that your actions are according to the sunnah. ولا يتأتى الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر إلا بعد فقه هذا الكتاب. And one will not have the correct understanding of what is enjoining good and forbidden the evil, except that he understands this book. Subhanallah. How great this statement is. Many people think they are enjoying good, but they cause more harm than good. Many people, they think they are forbidding evil, but they cause more harm than good. Enjoining good and forbidding the evil has conditions. Has principles. If we don't follow those principles, we will end up not enjoining good, but rather forbidding the good and enjoining evil. And this is apparent in the Khawarij. The Khawarij, they thought they were enjoining good. What did they end up doing? Killing the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum. The Khawarij, they thought they were enjoying good. They used to worship the nights. They used to fast the days. They used to read Quran, but it wouldn't go beyond their throats. يقرؤون القرآن ولا يفوت حناجرهم. It won't go beyond their throats. يمرقون من الدين كما يمرق السهم من كما تمرق السهم من الرمية. They will leave the deen just as the arrow enters the hunted animal. This is the Khawarij. Worshipping on this. Well, what was the problem then? The problem was aqidah. They believe. What did they believe in? They believe that Muslims with major sins, they will be in the hellfire forever. And that's why Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhuma, Jabir, the son of a companion, Abdullah radiallahu anhu, his father was martyred in Uhud, the battle of Uhud. His father said to him before that battle, you stay with your sisters, I will go. His son Jabir said, no, you stay, I will go. You stay with your daughters, I will go. They were competing to see who's going to go. Subhanallah. Shuf. How they used to be at that time. The Sahaba radha anhum. Give their life for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In a legitimate battle. Not like giving your life in an illegitimate battle. Killing yourself, putting suicide belt around you. It's haram to kill yourself with your own hands. It's forbidden. There's no proof from the Quran and Sunnah to say you can kill yourself with your own hands. Not one proof. There are confusions that people bring. Yes. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Don't kill yourselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ. Don't cause destruction with your own hands. So we find Jabir radiallahu anhu said to his father, no, I'll go. And obviously he had to obey his father in the end. So he stayed behind looking after his sisters. And that's why one time when Jabir radiallahu anhu, when he met the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him after that, he said to him, did you get married? He said, yes. He said, did you get married to a matron or a virgin? He said, I got married to a matron, yani someone who's older. And he said, why didn't you get married to a virgin? Yani someone younger, she plays with you, you play with her. Subhanallah, tula'ibuha wa tula'ibuk. He said, and then he explained that he has sisters and he needed someone older in order to look after his sisters. Allahu Akbar. So he took the advice of his father to look after his sisters. And even in his own dunya affairs, he married someone older in order for his wife to look after his sisters. And this is the state of the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum. Jabir radhiyallahu anhu was teaching under the in Medina, in Masjid al-Nabawi. Two or three of the Khawarij, they came from Iraq. They passed by. And they said, let's listen. They passed by. They're ready now to go out against the ruler. But they said, let's just listen. They're listening to Jabir radhiyallahu anhu, and he's explaining the hadith of Jahannamiyun. Those who will be punished in the hellfire, and then for a certain amount of time, and then they will be taken out and cleaned, forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when he passed and he heard this, they heard this for the first time. A Muslim major sins. He's going to be in the fire only for a short period of time, and then come out. And then come out. They never heard this before, because they used to believe that a Muslim who dies, who has major sins, then he is a disbeliever and he will be in the hellfire forever. Nasallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is their belief. And because of this belief, the Messenger said, they are the dogs of the hellfire. Kilabun nar. It shows you the importance of aqeedah. It shows you that the heaviest thing on the scales on Yawm al-Qiyamah is the aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah. So how are you going to meet Allah with the correct aqeedah or not? Why is it the ulama wrote many books on aqeedah? Showing you the importance of this great belief of Ahlul Sunnah. Very important. Because if the Khawarij were worshippers, and yet they are the dogs of the hellfire, because of their aqeedah, then indeed we must be very careful not to have the wrong belief. We must be careful not to fall into the incorrect belief. Because we may end up being like them or worse than them. Nasallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Jabir radiallahu anhu was teaching the hadith of the Jahannamiyun. Hadith which you can find. Hadith of Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, which is in Kitab al-Tawheed in Sahih al-Bukhari, the last book of Sahih al-Bukhari. He says, they said to him, what is this you are saying, O Jabir? The first time now they heard this hadith. He said, don't you read Quran? Subhanallah. Because they said to him, what is this you are saying, O Jabir? Didn't Allah say in the Quran, كُلَّمَا أَرَادُوا أَن يُدْخِلُوا فِيهَا كُلَّمَا أَرَادُوا أَن يُخْرِجُوا مِنْهَا أُعِيدُوا فِيهَا. Every time they want to come out, they are returned to it, meaning the hellfire. Every time they want to come out, they are returned to it. This is for the kuffar, not for the believers. So they would use those verses for the kuffar and apply them to the believers. So Jabir radiallahu anhu said, don't you read Quran? This was his answer. Allahu Akbar. And many of the misguided groups nowadays, Jama'at al-Takfir, Jama'at al-Jihad, Jama'at al-Ikhwan al-Muslimin, Tabligh, and all of them will unite with the sword in the end. All of them, they have no problem with going out against the rulers. And as many of the ulama of the past have mentioned, we say to them, don't they read Quran? Don't they read Quran? Didn't Allah speak against splitting? Didn't Allah mention against the misguided aqeedah and misguided groups? Didn't Allah mention against Hizbiyya partisanship? Don't they read Quran? And so when they mentioned this verse to him, he mentioned to them the Maqam al-Mahmud. Don't you remember the Maqam al-Mahmud? That station which is given to Rasulullah ﷺ, and he will intercede for the believers. Don't you remember that? SubhanAllah. And some of them turned back and some of them continued. And this shows you that the da'wah, لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ مُسَيْطِرِ. You cannot force anyone to follow the da'wah of haq. People will choose in the end. People will choose either haq or batil. You cannot force them. الَّذِي لَا يتفقه لا يتأتى منه الأمر المعروف والنهي عن المنكر. So the one who doesn't understand, who doesn't learn the fiqh, he will not be able to uphold enjoining good and forbidding the evil. So he thinks he's enjoining good, but he's actually forbidding he's enjoining evil. He thinks he's forbidding the evil, but he is forbidding the good. Yeah, because why? He didn't learn from the Ahl al-Ilm. إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمِ بِالتَّلَقِّي. He learned from the books. Or he learned for a short period of time. Ibn Uthaymeer, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeer, rahmullah, said, half a scholar will corrupt, will corrupt the deen. How about half a student? Half a nobody. Nasallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he thinks he's somebody. How much will he corrupt of the deen? Because he thinks he knows, and he ends up causing more harm than good. الذي لا يعرف المعروف كيف يأمر بالمعروف. The one who doesn't know that which is good, how will he know what is good? And how will he know how to enjoin good? He will not know. والذي لا يعرف المنكر كيف ينهى عن المنكر. The one who doesn't know evil, how will he know how to forbid it? إلا في الأمور الواضحة التي يشترك فيها حتى الكفار يعرفون أنها منكر. Except for the affairs that are apparent, even the kuffar know that it is not good. Even the kuffar know that it is evil. والمنكرات لا تعرف أنها منكرة إلا من خلال كتاب الله ومن سنة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the evil is not known except for, by way of the Quran and the Sunnah. ومن نعم ومنها العقائد الضالة. And from it is the misguided belief. والأفكار المنحرفة and the deviated thoughts and ways. وأقوال الملاحدة and the statements of the atheists. والزنادقة the heretics. وأقوال الروافد وأهل الباطل and the statements of the روافد, those who curse and revile the companions, and may Allah curse them for whom they curse, يعني because they curse the companions. May Allah curse those who curse the companions. وأهل الباطل and they bring and the أفكار of أهل الباطل, the people of futility. هذه لا يعرفها ولا ينهى عنها إلا من يفهم كتاب الله وسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So none will know these affairs, these misguidances, or these types of misguidance, except those who have been given understanding of the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And understanding is not memorizing, ya ikhwan. Memorizing is one thing, and understanding is another. And this is why the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to Ibn Abbas, Allah muwaffiqhu fi al-din wa 'allimhu al-ta'wil, or Allah give him understanding of the religion and teach him the interpretation. Understanding, ya ikhwan, is not just memorizing. It's easy to memorize, but understanding, you must sit with Ahlul Ilm, with the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah, and take the hikmah from them. Not just the memory and memorizing, but take the understanding, the wisdom of how to apply what you have learnt from the Ahlul Ilm. And many people cause more harm than good because they haven't been given that training. They haven't been given enough training. فهذا, and this is why you see them, subhanAllah, this is ajeeb.